Welcome to Book Club for Movies, everybody, for the week of April 5th.
Welcome.
I'm Ryan Miller.
He's a Ryan Miller. Why did you say it like that? You said, I'm a Ryan Miller.
Like what, sir?
You said it like, did you watch the Super Mario Brothers?
Sir Matthew Amberg.
Because you said it like, it's a me, a Ryan Miller.
Is there anything wrong with that? That's classic. He's a beloved character.
He is a beloved character.
I am now beloved. That's how that works.
Yeah, that's actually true. On the internet, we've said so. It's out there.
On Book Club for Movies, where we do one movie a week and say, please watch it and come over and talk to us. Please, we're lonely. At podcast@bookclubformovies.com or Facebook and Twitter, where we also exist in some form or another. Now it's time for the rest of the show.
It's the rest of the show show.
So we, every now and then, watch more than one movie a week. Everything's a lie. And they pile up.
Mm.
In fact, more often than not, we get to the rest of the show where we just kind of talk about what else is going on. Am I preaching to the choir here?
You're preaching.
It plays so well in a video. In a video medium.
We are the vidiots.
And this is one of those weeks where we've watched so many, it seems that they've piled up on us. And we need to get them all out. So we're going to forego a traditional movie of the week. For several movies of the week, the only question I have is, Matt, what kind of fake pretense do you want to give this one?
Well, I think that the best kind of pretense we can give is that we are so important and so good. We can't just limit ourselves to one movie all the time.
Is that redundant? Is every pretense fake?
Yes.
Okay.
I agree.
Circle gets the square.
Yeah, all right, Jim J. Bullock.
Because sometimes in the past, we, Shadow Stevens.
Shadow Stevens.
We make it like a volleyball thing where we throw them off, and not a TV volleyball, a movie volleyball.
No, that would be, it would be illegal. We would actually be infringing upon ourselves, and I don't even want to try to get into that kind of legal situation.
And you may not know this, but at some point, I believe I called it movie chicken, where it was like whoever blinks first as we toss movies back and forth at each other. I don't remember who won.
It was probably me.
And then I think there was the unspoken third option where we just have a conversation.
Ugh. I mean, let's be real. Who listens to podcasts anymore, for one? And then two, who listens to them where you're like, oh, I got an idea. Let's have a conversation. The only people that listen to podcasts anymore, like the only shows anybody listens to, we could have a conversation if we were talking about somebody being brutally murdered. And that's it. It's true crime or nothing. Everything else is just, you got to have a gimmick.
Real quick, has either one of us murdered anybody?
I mean, I don't want to really admit anything on a podcast. Well,
if I'm correct, I think most of the true crime stuff, like the guys, they get away with it. So
that's not it at all.
No,
definitely the other way around. It's there.
I'll have to check with my wife. Honestly.
Yeah. So the true crime thing is always the husband, and he always killed them.
Wait. So which one of us is the husband?
I mean, in this relationship, I feel like we're going to kill each other very soon.
Okay. We're both the husbands here.
We're both guilty.
Book Club for Movies. So, I mean, we're kidding ourselves. I'm probably just going to name the episode Cow Volleyball, so whatever. Who wants to begin?
Okay.
I guess this is the more important question.
Let me ease us into this by picking up just some stragglers from our Marvel journey.
I think you do have more movies than I do, so this is probably a good idea that you begin.
Unless,
can I ask you a quiz?
You can crisscross will make you jump. Your shirt is on backwards.
I have some Fast and Furious bits.
You have to hold on to those.
But I feel like it concerns the entire franchise, and I feel like you're making that trip soon or in the middle of it.
I can finish that. That's actually one that I can finish because there are still three I have not seen. So
okay. Maybe I'll save those.
I will see those, with the amount of stuff I might be able to actually get to those next week though. So we'll figure that out.
Either way, just without giving away my hand too much here. Let's just say I will not be mentioning any of the Fast and Furious movies that I watch with my family and daughter.
Because I did just recently watch the first three. So
all right, you're getting there.
The drift has been done.
That is within the first three, I think.
It's the third one.
You going chronological? No, you're going, if that's the case, you went release.
I went release date, yeah.
Yeah.
Although, okay. Oh, that's a good idea. Maybe I will flop it to chronological. Is there a list of chronological, how that goes?
Is there a list, Matt? Let me send you a link from the internet.
Please do. I hope it's similar to that site I sent you last night. That's not in the book.com or whatever.
Oh, boy. We could do a show on that, everybody. Yeah, no, shout it out. That's a...
I think that's what the site was called. I found it last night when I don't remember why. I don't even know how I came across it. But it is absolutely a website wherein somebody has gone through, or multiple people have gone through, and they split out the movie between the comic and the movie, or the book and the movie, and they break out all the differences. And it's...
I was going to say, yeah, not just comic, like any book, they and by number. Like each movie has a score by the end of it that's like, this movie has... The front page I saw was Gatsby, Great Gatsby was on there.
Yeah, yeah.
78 differences or something like that. I don't know, but yes.
And you were like, and there weren't enough.
It seems endlessly entertaining for me, who very often doesn't participate in that at all.
Oh, I love it. I loved it. I went through a few of them last night. I went down the rabbit hole with Watchmen, and now I actually want to sit down and watch Watchmen, which I haven't
show
seen
or
in
movie.
A long time.
Movie. Gotcha.
Yeah. So easing into this volleyball situation, I'm going to just catch you up on the Marvel movies. We're nearing the end. We finished up the final two before the Infinity War and Infinity, whatever the last one's called, Endgame.
Endgame.
I hate that it's called Endgame, I think. I think I'm actually
what? It's
over...
the last one. What else are you going to call it?
Yeah. No, I get it. I just hate it. And I also hate that that you didn't even say the name of the movie in the movie that you named it. You named it after a line from the previous movie.
Does it never come? Oh, they say
no,
it in Infinity War.
No, because he says, we're in the end game now, and then he dies. And they go, blah, blah, blah.
Hmm.
So Thor Ragnarok and Ant-Man and the Wasp. You know, honestly, I don't. There's not much to say about Ragnarok. I think Ragnarok is one of those simple movies that you just kind of, like, it is, out of all of the movies, and this is going to be kind of a funny thing to say, but it's more of a way for me to connect this to something. It's like, it's very much so the Indiana Jones, like the Raiders of the Lost Ark of the entire Marvel franchise for me, where I could universally go back to just that movie, not care about the rest of them, and just really, really enjoy every moment of it.
Sure.
I don't know. It's just kind of this perfect, weird, it's space, or maybe it's Flash Gordon, I guess, even though it's got that feel to it. But I love it. Like, I can always watch that movie and it always brings me joy. All the stupid little bits with Korg are great. Like, they're some of the best bits, is like one of the best characters to introduce. We're going to get on that giant ship. You want to come? Like, just terrific stuff. All the stuff with Loki, they did such a good job. When you watch these movies in a short period of time, you do get you can see where character choices started to become more prevalent and apparent. And Loki, I think, is one of those characters that really ended up benefiting. Like, he was always a fun character. Hiddleston did a great job starting right from the beginning. But by the time you get to Ragnarok, that character has so much more pathos than he does at the very beginning. He's like more confident in that role. There's something more to that, like the shoes that he has to fill. And you get that fantastic fight at the end where with Hera and the Valkyries and Thor and the Hulk comes back. And also one of the funniest things in all of those movies, maybe the funniest thing to me is, that moment towards the end where Valkyrie still has no idea who Banner is, only recognizes him as the Hulk, and he goes, "You'll see," and he jumps out of the ship and just wham, as a human, hits the Rainbow Bridge, and everybody just kind of, "The hell was that?"
Moving on.
Yeah.
No, yeah, I can see Taika keeping that in his pocket for like an entire movie. Like, no, nope, not yet. Hey, should we, I don't know why I'm the Rock guy all of a sudden. Should we have him be the Hulk in the movie at the moment? Nope.
Not yet. Just
wait.
Not yet. So I love that. And it was great.
I mean, Ragnarok, when you say there's not much to say about it, I feel like that's because it's top tier almost. And I do agree that you can kind of watch it at any point. But yeah, and I'm sure we've gushed about it enough already ourselves.
That's kind of it.
Hearing you mention all the different things, it's been long enough that I've seen it, that I'm like, well, yeah, that's right. That was in there too. Like, it wasn't, I think Ragnarok, and I think, oh, it's a perfect comedy. You know, like, it's a perfect one of those. But then you're mentioning like Hera and all this stuff. I'm like, that's right, she's in that too. Oh, freaking Urban's in it. Like,
yep.
That movie literally has every single thing going for it.
No, I fully admit, like, there is that movie also is the movie I told Beth. I was like, this movie is far and away the sexiest Marvel movie, because you've got
Carl Urban.
Super hot Thor.
What the heck is Urban's character's name? I forget.
Scourge.
There it is.
You got super hot, super sexy Chris Hemsworth, super sexy Jeff Goldblum, super sexy Kate Blanchett, super sexy Tom Hiddleston. Like, the list just goes on and on. Rock guy, Korg. How can you not be into that? He's rock hard.
Taika's voice, just sexiest voice
super
award.
Sexy. Hey, dude. But that movie also has just, like, I love all the implications given to that story overall that Thor, we still are going to have to deal with. Like, we still haven't gotten to deal with Ragnarok occurring, that Hela came in and she did wipe away 99% of Asgard in terms of the people themselves, but also Asgard is gone, like, it's been raised, and
they don't seem, we spoke about this recently, that Ragnarok, the thing nobody ever talks about is that it comes back after, always, that's part of the thing,
right?
They haven't really mentioned that in the movies, I feel like.
No, not been, no, not at all. It's just that Ragnarok is the end of all ends, and so I'm kind of curious where Love and Thunder is going to come from and how that's going to work and tie in
a lot. That might be my most anticipated at this point.
Oh, in terms of how that's tying in, because that movie to me is gotta be something that ties these two like broken up phases of, you know, the Thanos phase and then the whoever the new big bad phase is going to be. So very exciting. And then we did watch Ant-Man and Wasp, which is the final movie in cinematic timeline before Infinity War and Endgame. We hadn't watched that. I think I've only seen it twice before. And on this third watch, or whatever watch this was, man, I like that movie even more this round. Like, it is, I think maybe knowing what it is going into it helps, but I forgot, like, I actually did forget a whole host of the movie. I forgot Ghost was the main antagonist, she was awesome. Like,
I like her a lot. Yeah,
great actually. Character, great,
I mean, I don't know, great character. Like, I like the gimmick, and I like her powers, and I think the performance is strong. I don't think there's a ton of... I don't want to say pathos because you've already said it, but also there might actually be, she might be only pathos. Like, I just feel like she's not quite complete. Like, she's not.
No, there could be more to her. She is not the most fully rounded character, but we also are, that movie is giving a whole lot of time to setting up what is ultimately going to be like setting up the family of the Pym particle, basically setting up,
right,
really giving more time to Wasp and to Scott in terms of their personal lives. So they did a lot of stretching that out. And that is one of the, maybe one of the faults is that part of the movie is Hank and I'm just blanking on Wasp's name right now. It's going to kill
Evangeline Lilly.
That's right. They spend 75% of the movie just mad at Scott for taking the suit and going to Germany and doing the Civil War thing. Like, they're just angry at him for that. And it's, instead of letting it go, like, they haven't spoken for the entire time he's been on house arrest, which for the movie now, like, and especially in the timeline, like, over a year, he's been stuck in the house. And it's like, it was one of those, like, for all of the nonsense that you got from Hank himself, that he would be angry about, like, I get it to a point, you stole my property, but on the same token, you clearly made him your successor to this character, to this suit.
Yeah, we kind of got over that in the first movie, really.
Yeah, no, we did. And it was just the fact that they retread it is it takes up too much of the time. This movie could become a significantly better movie if the next Ant-Man movie is fed strongly off of the family themes with him and his daughter. Especially because she is very familiar with that he's Ant-Man. She knows this. In the comics, she becomes Stature. She gets powers and everything, and she can do stuff too.
Dude, yeah, do like a live-action Incredibles. Like, that could be...
so fun.
Like, it hasn't been done, number one, in the MCU so far. But yeah, we got... I mean, Michelle Pfeiffer, I think, is still in the picture at the end of that movie, right? Also?
Well, at the end of the movie, nobody's really in the picture because they all blip.
Oh.
But
sure. Okay.
But yes, in the grand scheme of it, they all, in theory, are going to blip back.
She doesn't. It's not like one of those things where she's like, I must go back into the universe for no reason at all. Like, she's actually, yeah, they get her back.
When she gets pulled out of the quantum realm, she's actually the, like, she's the, and this is one of those bits that I didn't like also because it fudges things in a way that we've gotten no explanation, which is now the next movie is begging for one, that because Ghost has basically a particle issue where she's falling apart and she can teleport herself and kind of phase in and out of things, but she's dying from it. Because of the quantum realm, there's something to do with how right. The quantum realm like collapsed on her or something. But then Michelle Pfeiffer comes out and just touches her face and now she's fine.
Well, that, I mean, yeah, I mean, that's, yeah.
And in comparison to so many other things they could have worked with, is an extremely underwhelming ending, you know?
Yeah, I feel like we came into this being like, this is, I liked it, it's good, better than I remembered and all this, and then we just kind of...
I like it way more. It's just not perfect in any way. It's yeah. That's all it is.
And even the beginning stuff, like... In fact, maybe that's the entire problem, I would say, with that movie, and this could probably be traced back to everything we've mentioned, is that it did seem a little bit more hamstrung by everything else that was going on in the universe, but also I think the choice at the beginning is emblematic because I think it was an obvious for pacing, like, we can't have Scott being the Ant-Man right at the beginning of the movie, right? They need that excuse for him to not get the suit until at the perfect moment, and then... Right. We're off to the races. Like, they needed to recreate a reason for that, and that seemed a little forced, I think, in the end.
The thing with it is just how long it goes. They could have kept all of that stuff and then trimmed it down, because you do get, like, there is that, it is a fantastic introduction with him and his daughter having to work with, I can't leave the house, so we got to do this and this, and she understands that, and she has moved past that, even to a point... The wife and the husband of their daughter, the ex-wife, like, they've now accepted that Scott, you know, he made a poor choice, but he's still a good person. Yeah.
Judy Greer, made a poor choice.
Yeah, Judy.
Made a really poor choice. Yeah. Make it work.
Next time she's going to go, we're going to find out she's the granddaughter of Michael Myers. It's going to be a whole situation.
Oh, see, I was going to go with, say goodbye to these.
Say goodbye to these. That's we did just watch a whole mess of those.
See, we did it. Ant-Man 2 is good. There we came back around.
It's true. Ant-Man 2 is good. I look forward to, we got to finish up Endgame and Infinity War, maybe in that order. We'll see.
I was going to say, you might want to, okay.
Yeah, you might want to. Maybe I want Thanos to win at the end, okay? We're going to switch it up.
I've been feeling like rewatching. It's been too soon since we did the whole, in fact, I guess it's probably been over a year now considering COVID happened, and that just seems like a black hole. But I think we need more time before we do them all again, but I have been thinking of doing at least those two. Even actually just Endgame, I've been thinking of doing.
This has worked out really well because we kind of started it right before WandaVision and then Falcon and Winter Soldier. So
right.
we're kind of in a great situation where we will finish these up right before the Loki show comes out.
Oh man, did you see? I don't watch a lot of trailers, but I opened up IMDb to pull some bad trivia for the stuff I've seen, and that new Loki trailer was front and center. And if Love and Thunder is at the top of my list, that might be a close second after that trailer.
So I fully, that show looks like it's a real high budget Legends of Tomorrow.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Well, it's got the time travel. Yeah. Which I didn't know was a part of it at all.
Which is fine. I'm totally into them doing the Time Bureau, and their version of Rip Hunter is
freaking
Owen Wilson. Which,
yeah.
Wow. I can't wait to hear how many. Wow. All right.
I would imagine he's scaling that back at this point in his career.
I hope not. Wow.
I hope not also, yeah.
Loki. Wow. All right, over to you.
So my first movie I'm going to title Tales from a Red State. Because I recently went to Idaho, you'll remember.
I do.
And while I was there, I had the opportunity to attend a theater. So hold on. I am vaccinated. That did happen. I'm considered at-home care for a special needs child, which bumped me. Actually, my wife did all the work. But
nice job, Katie.
So
I got part one done. I got to get part two still.
Yeah, I'm curious about part two. Part two wasn't super fun for me, but it wasn't as bad as I've heard, and I certainly have heard worse. But yeah, I didn't feel like doing anything for that day.
Woo!
Certainly. The CDC has some new guidelines for vaccinated people. I checked out. I was still masked up, and we went to the matinee, which ended up having just one other family in there at the end of the day. So honestly, the only question I had at that point was if I wanted to patronize any theater that was kind of encouraging new or resumed activities. And I think in most cases the answer would be no. Like if my local Regal opens back up, I'm not like they can suck it for a while. Like I've had bad experience with them already for a while. So but I have wanted to, and this sounds weird, for the longest time patronize this particular theater in Idaho in my wife's hometown, because they have very consciously approached their business model from a movies or theaters are ripoffs point of view.
Big fan.
And everything is reasonably priced. I think they make up for it by having a better selection of things, you know, cheese curds included. Do you have a reliable cheese curds vendor in Colorado?
Not that I can think of.
Okay. Well, I do not either.
I mean, we have them here, but like the closest thing I think we have is like in terms of fast food, we have Culver's, which I mean, they're okay, but they're not my favorite.
All right. Well, no cheese curds up in here.
If you want cheese curds, I can easily get them for you because Bridget sends them to us on a regular basis.
You can be my cheese curds dealer from here on out. First one's free, buddy.
I got a trench coat. You want some cheese curds? I got yellow. I got white.
Those look different than yesterday. Yeah.
They still squeak when you bite into them.
Yes. So the answer was yes. I was like, okay, I'll patronize these guys. I've wanted to, whatever, all the other reasons I mentioned before.
Okay.
And we went and saw Raya the Last Dragon.
Oh, so, nice.
Yeah. The latest.
Kelly Marie Tran.
Yes. It plays the Sisu. Sisu, I think, is the name of the dragon in there. Okay. So
Awkwafina.
Yes, maybe actually that's who I was thinking.
She plays the dragon. The main character is Kelly Marie Tran.
Okay, sorry. Yes, that makes much more sense. Obviously, when you hear.
And I don't remember who plays her little friend. She's got
You're asking me so many specific questions about this movie that I was prepared to mention as a side note. Well, hold on. So, Raya is a perfectly fine movie. I say while also typing IMDb into the browser here. And again, with Disney movies, I feel like there's a positivity to them that I want to patronize as well.
It was Alan Tudyk who's...
Alan Tudyk. Him. Gosh dang it. You still got two before I did. Wait, and I forgot to mention Alan Tudyk? Is that... Jeez. This movie's much better than I gave it credit for. No, it's fine. It's totally cool. It's just that... The gold standard is this movie can be watched by adults and kids.
Of course.
I think adults can enjoy this still, but it's not like one of the best examples of that.
Okay.
I think
That's
it ends up being a little more simplistic, and maybe this is your mileage will vary depending on, you know, how self-actualized you are in the moral that it's teaching this time. And in this one, it's essentially trust. Like, the main character was hurt, so she finds it hard to trust. And the entire movie, with the help of Awkwafina, is helping her to trust again and to trust the main bad guy, in a way, who betrayed her to begin with. So it's that. And it's probably a very good one of that. It just doesn't seem to delve too deep or in any novel way into that. So if that's a concept you understand and don't have a real big issue with, then you might be less than engaged for the entirety of it. There's not necessarily enough jokes to keep you going there too, but it's good. It's, again, this is way too much. I think the question I come to, because I am in this spot, is it sincere? And I think the movie is sincere. So,
One thing that I can't speak much to it, but I can point you to people who did, Kelly Marie Tran and, Kulap Vilisok, who's Scott Aukerman's ex-girlfriend,
yes.
Because
he married her.
Kulap is from Laos, if I remember correctly.
Sounds right.
I don't recall where Kelly Marie Tran is directly from, but they talked about this on Comedy Bang Bang when Kelly Marie Tran was on there a few weeks back. Totally great little back and forth between the two of them, because they do talk about how one of the few things that doesn't really come up a lot is well-treated cultural stuff from places like Laos and Asia. It can be fetishized in weird ways and a number of other things. And they were both real jazzed about how much representation was brought into this movie, which I think is cool. And it was something that the way they both talked about it is it's totally that, oh, now I actually want to see it because I want to see what they're looking for, you know.
You are 1,000,000%, and I feel like I did the same thing with Moana, which I wasn't super hot on, but the music is kind of can get you a lot further into it. Lin-Manuel Miranda, all that stuff. You're right. I totally should have mentioned that. It is a beautiful example of something like that. Like, it's especially from Disney, who has a checkered past in that department. They seem to be making grand strides and putting the right people in charge for stuff like this. What I really wanted to mention, actually, though, is the short that comes before Raya called Us Again, which has nothing to do with Jordan Peele.
I'm already out.
And
if we're not getting an animated version of those crazy eyes, I'm not interested.
You're getting an animated version of an elderly couple. The entire short is told through dance. And honestly, it's only 7 minutes long, so it's a very quick thought process here. But the first few seconds of it, I gotta admit, I wasn't like, it seemed a little too easy. I'm like, oh, this is, you know, here we go. It just seemed too easy, too Disney, too even just animated short at this point. You know, like, there's such a feel and thing to all of them at this point that this is complete jaded me coming out. But man, by the third minute mark, they had me fully. Like, the entire experience was worth that short alone.
Nice.
And there was a moment that I won't spoil again, 4 minutes in maybe, that I teared up at more than I teared up at anything in Raya. So it does a lot of heavy lifting in a very short amount of time. So Us Again, definitely.
Great.
Whenever that shows up anywhere, but not in the theater.
Cry at cartoons again.
Crying at cartoons is back. Us Again in theaters. It was in theaters only. I'm sure it's, you know, it'll come out eventually. Might already be out.
I'm watching it on my watch.
And I'll stop there before I do anything else. I regret.
So. All right, I'm gonna keep going with the double hitters here. These two are connected through character, played by very different people, made at very different times. One very good, the other one very Rob Schneider. I did watch both Judge Dredd and Good Dredd, but not, it's not called Good Dredd. It's just called Dredd, but it's the good version of Judge Dredd.
Double whammy.
So the Judge Dredd was Sylvester Stallone, Diane Lane, I think was the is the other judge like impossibly young Diane Lane now, especially after seeing
Justice League
where she's like impossibly old. I don't understand it. It's like time has moved along. I don't know what's going on.
She defies time in any incarnation.
What a weird movie, because again, so you got Stallone, Diane Lane, Max von Sydow, Jürgen Prochnow, Armand Assante, and Rob Schneider. Super weird movie that in no way understood the characters
or the story or
anything that made Judge Dredd. However, and I don't remember who it was. It was like Gucci or something. Some crazy high-end designer made the suits, and they're awful. Like, they are terrible.
They're awful, but like if the movie, I feel like, understood anything, it kind of understood pop art in a comic book sense, which probably isn't attributable to Dredd necessarily at all.
Oh,
in
I
a
doubt
way,
it.
But
yeah,
I kind of like that movie, honestly.
No, I actually, it's super funny. It's really weird. The entire we want to take over Mega City One. How do we do it? Well, we've got to get rid of the worst judge, or quote, or the best judge, depending on how you look at it. The one guy who can't be bought, who can't be lied to. It's Judge. We got to get rid of him. And to get rid of him, we got to get rid of Max von Sydow. So, okay, we're gonna throw them into the wastelands. They're gonna fight some cannibals. They're gonna come back. He's gonna wear the helmet one time, and then you're only gonna see Stallone's face. And
yeah, could have predicted that one, I'm sure.
Oh yeah, for sure. It's similar to, it's the same concern everybody has with a masked character. You know, like even Deadpool, it was, how much are we gonna see Ryan Reynolds' face? To which anybody who was familiar with Deadpool went, well, that could be fun.
Everyone, a concern that everyone has, Matt?
Yes, everyone.
I don't think Carl Urban has that concern.
Except for Carl Urban, who in fact had the opposite concern, because Dredd, the movie, is so good. I mean, that movie is outstanding. Not only does it get the characters, it not only does it understand like what that city is and where they are. Carl Urban clearly loves the character, never takes the mask off. We only see him in silhouette without the helmet on. For about 2 seconds at the very beginning.
And even that.
Yeah, he still basically looks like he's wearing the helmet. Lena Headey is great. The entire idea of a drug called slow-mo that makes everything go slow motion for the person. Like, and then all of these people are getting thrown off the edge of buildings while being put on it. Like, horrifying.
Yet cinematically convenient.
It worked out great. It did. It worked out very well. But man, this movie is totally, hey, I got an idea. Let's put Carl Urban in the Judge Dredd outfit and then put him in the movie The Raid. And somebody went, there we go. That's it.
It's super raidy. Yeah.
That's how you make a smaller budget Judge Dredd movie while still building an entire world around him. And it worked, man. The psychic Anderson, his partner, she's great. Super fun character. That movie looks fantastic overall. It's cool. Watch Dredd.
That was Pete Travis. Yeah, actually, I don't know him by name.
I remember looking that up and going, who the hell are you, Pete? You're doing a good work, a single good work.
He's doing a TV work at this point, it seems like. But he directed Endgame.
That was it?
The 2009 movie.
Yeah, basically the same thing.
He directed the end game that Marvel was completely fine with being like, yeah, well, it doesn't matter. Nah, we can name our movie something that's already been taken.
Yeah, you guys can sue us for that. We'll give you the $30.
Nobody's going to care. I don't know any of these things that he has done. It looks like he went into TV, after Dredd, almost exclusively.
Yeah, it's a cool movie. Highly recommend watching it. Fun. Really brutal, too, man. I forgot how gory that movie is.
I feel like, wasn't that a Dredd thing? Isn't that
it's not Dredd gory. Accurate? Yeah. There's definitely gore in Judge Dredd. I just forgot how gory the movie itself was.
Nice, which I'm sure that's a nice surprise for you.
I always. I'm a fan, man.
I'm going to keep with the good vibes here, was going to be my segue from the stuff I did last, but it now doesn't work.
Oh, wow.
I watched the twofer of Won't You Be My Neighbor and Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood, or A Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood.
Man, I do not think I'm emotionally cut out for those movies.
So the first one is the documentary, and I think I might have put it off. I put it off for two reasons. The reason you're talking about, yeah, sure, this is the Mr. Rogers documentary, and because I wanted my daughter to see it. And I think we started a few times at night, and it doesn't necessarily, I mean, documentaries on their own aren't the first thing you want to turn on right before you go to bed anyway. So when we finally did get to it, I don't think I was more sad by the end of it. Let's put it that way. I don't think I was left with a larger hole in my heart. I think it does a good job of lifting you up. So I think my concerns maybe in that area were unfounded, but
I'm definitely not emotionally ready for that.
It's good. It's good. And I really, truly did not know even then how remarkable of a man that dude is.
It was crazy.
And yeah, he's at the top of my list and has been for a very long time. And I never watched the shows religiously, but whenever it was on, I don't ever remember turning the channel. You know, when I was young enough to appreciate it. Certainly, I got to an age where, you know, you get to that age where you don't like anything that's good.
And you're just saying, Mr. Rogers.
that's what happened, though. Yeah, word for word.
And then so, your father went, that's it, I'm done surfing, we're going to church.
Even though he has been way up there for my whole life, just the documentary, I had no idea to what extent. And yeah, the documentary does a fantastic job, is very good.
Nice.
That man is great, etc., etc.
And how was Tom Hanks as that man?
I waited longer on that one because I don't know. It didn't look fantastic to me, I'll put it that way.
Sure.
It occupies that realm of movies that seem like an SNL skit from the announcement. You know, like there was, I think the first one, and I mentioned this a million times, is the Lincoln movie, which ended up being fan freaking tastic, but Daniel Day-Lewis as Abraham Lincoln, I'm like, this is a digital short, you know, like it ended up being fantastic. It directed by Steven Spielberg. He's director that just steals ideas.
Steven Spielberg, is that what you called it? That's good, I like it.
But ended up being fantastic. The A Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood had the same type of vibe, and Tom Hanks just seemed like too obvious of a choice. And honestly, I might have been able to do with somebody else in the role.
Sure.
I like Tom Hanks fantastically, even though I feel like we've been unfriendly to him most recently with News of the World. Not that his performance was really the issue in that, I guess.
No, it's not the performance. It's just, I mean, that overall movie was just not
in script. And
it's funny though that you mentioned this, because I will say that the other biopic that he did that was okay, but it's not anything to write home about, was Saving Mr. Banks.
Yeah, I agree. I have seen that, and yeah, I agree not to write. But if you think about it, that's not even the other one. Like, he's been on this biopic tear for quite some time with Captain Phillips and...
Oh, yeah, I forgot about that terrible movie.
There's like a zillion more that the IMDb is not loading, so I can't tell you about. Here
and,
it
and
is!
And he was Sully! He was Sully, too!
Sully, there you go. That's another one I'm thinking of.
Yeah, he is anyway. On a real, like, real kick of, I can be real people! You are real, Tom.
Okay. Well, A Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood, the narrative imagining of a moment in Fred Rogers' life where there is a, not a biography, like an article done on him.
Like an op-ed or
No.
No. That's... slander. Libel.
Well, I guess that's the issue, is because the reporter assigned to it is one that has had familial issues and is a broken person, it seems, in some ways. His editor puts him on this assignment. You know, the movie kind of hints, or you bring that to the movie kind of expecting a movie like that, that she knows he needs this. I don't know if it was exactly that. Certainly in real life, I don't know, you know. But you kind of get the idea of the movie from then on out, is that through his interaction with Fred Rogers, he will be healed in one way or another. The main relationship is with his father that is bad, that he has to kind of patch up. And the father's played by Chris Carter, actually. Chris Carter. No, that's the... Chris Cooper.
From the X-Files?
Yes, dang it. Yes, he does a really good job. No,
weird.
Chris Cooper.
We were watching that last night.
The X-Files? I haven't watched the latest season, so...
I'm a fan. Fourth episode of season one.
Oh, that's good. That's okay. No, Chris Cooper, who's usually great. And in fact, when I think about it, at one point I had the notion that, man, I might have wanted to see Chris Cooper as Mr. Rogers, which doesn't work, doesn't fit. But instead of, it seems like he would have had an edge that the documentary very much emphasizes or shows, you know, that's part of the charm of it, is that they're like, you know, here is when Mr. Rogers did blow up a 30-foot sign of his stage manager mooning him and display it for everyone to see or something. You know, like
I remember reading that his wife mentioning that he thought farts were hilarious. So.
Oh, really? That's fantastic. He's a good man. I told you he's great.
Yeah, that's how you know. Are farts funny? Yes, you're a good man.
So I had some reluctance with A Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood, but it overcame it for two, I think, big reasons. The aesthetic that the movie chooses to use is that all of the establishing shots are done like they are those Mr. Rogers.
The models,
yeah,
right?
Those tiny towns. Yeah.
I love that.
It's beautiful, number one, but also it does kind of give this feeling that, oh, it's his world. We just live in it, even though I'm not sure that's the message or the exact takeaway, but it plays with it more. And I feel like when I talk about biopics, I talk about the difference between something like Love and Mercy, which was just this kind of out there, like went more for a feeling than anything else, you know, than historical accuracy or stuff like that.
Sure.
This occupies a middle ground, which is better than no ground at all. Like, I'm glad that you just didn't want to tell this story, which, yeah, would have been a little trite, I feel like.
Better or worse than Loving Vincent? Yeah.
I mean.
There you go. Now I've broken
it's
you.
So different, but I guess in the way that it's using the medium to tell the story, because that is the best part of the film, is where they bring this jaded reporter into, like, he has a dream sequence where basically he's in the world of you know, with Daniel the Tiger and some of the
That's
models
fun.
And stuff like that. And it is a beautiful moment, and I think it is centered in the film, so it's paced really well. But by the end, yeah, in fact, not even by the end, by halfway through, I'm like, okay, this is working. This is better than good and totally worth watching.
Anyway, nice.
Yeah. It's weird because most of the movie is spent not with Mr. Rogers, and you feel like that's going to be a mistake, and certainly for the first act, I'm like, where it's taking a lot of time to introduce you to this reporter and his family and his child and his father. I'm like, I don't know that I want to know. Like, I don't know that, like, I would rather be learning about Mr. Rogers right now in some way or what he's going through. Like, I don't really care about this. You know, I don't know that I care about this, and they make me care about it. So all credit.
Like, nice.
Good movie. Worth watching in the end and in the middle.
All right.
To you.
Oh, okay. Well, I'll continue on with the documentary thing. Hulu has a documentary made by Soleil Moon Frye, who some of you may remember as Punky Brewster.
I did not watch this in time. I was going
to. Oh, do you want me to wait?
No. Go.
It's called Kid 90. And it's a really interesting documentary.
Well, let me ask you, do you want to wait to have a back and forth, or would you like to just talk about it?
No, actually, this is totally worth a discussion because of the content surrounding it. Is there's a couple of interesting things in particular that it is. I'll give everybody like kind of a little preview of it. Basically, okay. When
in a world.
right after Soleil Moon Frye kind of made her name with Punky Brewster, she, like most kid stars, found other Hollywood kid stars and ended up making friends with them and growing up around them. And at one point she's given a video camera, and she basically recorded hundreds upon hundreds of hours of her life with her friends. And so you get an interesting, real kind of, this is stupid, but a real raw look at what she and her friends were doing, thinking, talking about, and during the 90s. And it's super interesting. So
I could have ended the opposite of what It said, especially, I get that because it's a young movie or star or TV star taking the video, that it's intrinsically more interesting, but that honestly does the opposite thing for me most of the time. So
yeah, this is more interesting. Like this was certainly more interesting to me than it might be to others, because like I grew up with that show along with all of those other kid stars and people that she kind of interacts with. Like, they were all in my wheelhouse because I'm only a few years younger than her.
Mm.
Like, all of these people, like, that pop up, I'm like, oh, I remember that person. I remember that person. That person was in. And, like, and you're told who they are. Like, it's not, nobody's, like, but there's some really interesting stuff in there.
Interesting in the way of, if you're interested in her as an artist, or interesting in, like, does she say something greater than?
No. I think there's, this is 100% a, here was what I went through, but this is a lot of things where a number of the things that she's going through are like things that girls are going to go through, but also kind of, it feeds into that. This is Hollywood for kids. And this is what Hollywood was like for these kids. And so I think it's interesting to see the back end of the, you know, we always hear stories of the Corey Feldman stuff. We've heard about, you know, like child stars forever, you know, since
the Corey Haim stuff.
Yeah. The other Corey. But no, and she admits that, This is something for her to kind of come to grips with a bunch of choices in her life and how she got to where she is. So the movie does work around the videos that she made as a kid, and then it jumps back to her present day and talking to a number of those people about the things that, like, showing them the videos, reading them her diary entries about those people, and getting their reactions and how they saw things.
That's a good hook. In a where are they now fashion, it's kind of even.
Oh, and
I'm not going to lie. You know, growing up in that time period and watching those people on TV, it's always interesting. I'm doing this a lot with skateboarding now, actually, because back then all I got were the names of professionals in videos, you know, skate videos. So you don't get a lot of personality, but videos and magazines.
Yeah.
So now that there's like this incredible girth of YouTube content and whatnot, like to see what was actually going on at the times, or to recontextualize that stuff from kind of the behind the curtain, I guess, for lack of a better term, you know, from the other direction, from another direction, is kind of fascinating no matter what.
There is a section of the movie that will specifically speak to actually that.
Okay. All right. Cool. I'm in. We'll come back to it then. That 15-minute discussion didn't count.
And then
disqualified. What do you got?
And then just because we've been doubling up, and it has some not a documentary in any respect, but we watched Bad Trip. It's a Netflix original. It's got Eric Andre and Lil Rel in it. And
I thought that was a stand-up, actually.
It is not. So this is actually pretty brilliant. I kind of love the idea, the execution on it. We'll talk about it a little more. If you've ever watched the Eric Andre show, you'd be familiar with he basically brings people on, and most of the people that come on don't really have an understanding of who he is or what his comedy is. And he's extreme absurdist, along with like real big into making people feel uncomfortable, but he tries to do it in a he gets naked a lot, so there's that's always a problem. but the
comedy,
the people come on the show, and he asks them obscene questions and does really stupid stuff. He always breaks his desk and breaks through the walls and stuff. It's really funny if you like absurdist humor. What they've done with this movie, Bad Trip, is they decided to basically do a hidden camera show with a narrative around it. So they've got a bunch of sequences that have these characters that have a story that they're trying to get from point A to point B. And then to do it, they've done a number of hidden camera bits where they play that character. They don't tell the other person, that like whoever the rando is, and they try to make that somehow fit into the movie.
Okay, this sounds brilliant.
And no, from a concept, it actually absolutely is. Like taking, doing that and putting a narrative around it, and then like there is some, like, we laughed out loud a number of times. The problem is that the bits don't always work, and you gotta wonder, okay, how many times did they go through this before they chose this take? And at the end of the movie, you do get some outtakes where they show, they're like, oh yeah, here's us telling everybody that there's a camera there. But from the concept through the execution, like, it's really, like, it's a very cool movie to watch knowing that. And it's pretty short. It's like an hour and a half, hour and 20 minutes.
So that was going to be my question. Is would you say the problem is that it has trouble sustaining that for the length of the movie, which I was going to ask how long. So now I know that it's an hour and a half. It seems
it's not a
dicey proposition.
It's not the concept that has the leg issue. It's definitely the gags they chose to do. I could see this being done on a way, like, a much more successful level, but also keeping in mind that a number of these things are, it's Eric Andre, so he's going for something real specific. But it works. If you like Eric Andre, you'll probably like the movie. It is totally a love story, stupid thing. It's not even a love story, really. It's his sister. it's his sister's in love with her car, not like, I love you, car, but, and they stole her car, and then she just got out of jail. So when you remember that, some of the bits get really, really funny. There are other times where it just doesn't land. Like, the jokes don't land. The bit that they were trying to pull off, it just didn't hit for me. But overall, it was worth watch. It's fun.
Here's a hard question.
Okay.
How much more success do you think it would have with... Actually, maybe that's a bad way to put that. How's the editing?
okay, so that's actually a really great question. And the answer here is that the editing is similar to the movie in that some of it doesn't work. But I also think that part of the issue is that you have these narrative bits that are being shot like a normal movie. Then you have these hidden camera bits that are not the same resolution. They're like almost using security cameras for some of it.
Interesting.
And some of it works, some of it doesn't. And but when they're doing the bit, they can't edit around that. Like, they're not editing into the middle of it. Like, when a bit begins with somebody who's not part of the movie, who's a random passerby, that's, you're getting that whole sequence. You're not getting we're doing the sequence, then we're editing, we're cutting to a narrative piece. It's you get a narrative piece, then you get the bit, then you get the narrative piece that picks up right after the bit.
See, that's something I think if they would have found some sort of multicam solution, I think that could have gone a long way. Like,
reason
very specifically that I ask is because, yeah, that premise sounds like it could fall apart in the editing room after the fact, especially if you don't have a ton to work with. And yeah, if they are limited in their angles, meaning they're limited in what they can edit, then yeah, I can see issues arising.
Yeah.
As an editor. So also Eric Andre, I feel like, which I do and have laughed very hard at his show at numerous moments, but, and I feel like he would enjoy this.
Hit or miss.
Yes, I have a very hit and miss relationship with his stuff. I think I started his stand up. In fact, this is why I haven't touched Bad Trip. It's because I started his stand up and fell off it very quickly, which, again, I know that's his, like, I feel like he would be happy with that. Like,
probably. Yeah.
Even if I would consider myself a fan, he would be pleased that he could release stuff for his fans that does not please them at times, you know, like,
yeah,
which totally is challenging. And I like that, certainly for a comedian. It's just, with comedy, it's especially hard because, you know, what are you there for if you're not in the right mindset? You know, I'm also a big fan of Tim Heidecker, who I feel like very, very often, like, pushes the limits of what comedy is and supposed to be. And you're supposed to realize that and engage with it in a very different way.
Yeah.
But yeah, you just got to be in the right mind. So
100%.
Interesting. Very interesting.
Yeah, it's totally worth a watch just to see even what did work and what doesn't. It's
yeah, that's true. Yeah,
it's a fun concept. Understood. And fun, it's a fun little movie if you've got you got some time to throw it on and get caught up in some of the stupidity of it.
I guess that's what I was going to say is I feel like, I don't know if this is because it's true or this is just the impression that's given, but because of all that and what we've already talked about, sometimes Andre's stuff seems a little thrown together. Like he doesn't take the time sometimes to make it as great as it could be or to execute on it as, which is a stupid thing to say. I don't know for sure. And that could be completely false.
The hard thing about this movie is definitely wondering how many takes they got and why they chose that one, you know, like, so for example, the opening bit is him working at a car wash or like an auto mechanic. And he's got a dude that's like, he's sitting in a chair and he's vacuuming the car. And he goes, "Hey man, can you turn the vacuum on?" And the guy turns the vacuum on and the vacuum is so powerful. And he also has like, he set up his uniform so that when the vacuum gets stuck to his uniform, it sucks the whole uniform off and he's just naked.
Right, there you go.
And then he has to like dive into the back of the car because the woman whose car he's vacuuming is coming by and he's like, "Oh man." And then the guy's like, "Oh dude, here, take my coat," you know, and it works. It's funny, but there's, you know, there's definitely the how many times did he do that before they were like, "That's fine. We'll find one of those works," because they can't edit it. You can't suddenly change the person that was sitting at the right. at the vacuum. You can't right. do that. So it's fun.
Yeah, it might just be because of the DIY nature. I mean, hidden cam stuff tends to look like that anyways.
Yes.
Like it might give it a more thrown together feeling than not, but cool. All right, yes. Bad trip.
Yeah.
Good trip altogether, you're saying.
Yeah, fun trip.
Fun trip.
I enjoyed it.
I only have one more movie, and it's my big one, so
okay.
I don't know where you're at on your list.
I guess we're going to cut it down.
No, yeah, that's fine. Maybe I'll tell you what. I'll give my big finale here, and in the time you give your next follow-up, I'll come up with a movie out of the blue that I watched recently and didn't write down.
Okay.
So, does this cast list sound familiar or intriguing to you at all? Violante Placido. Kieran Hines.
Kieran Hines. Do you like Steppenwolf?
Was he Steppenwolf?
Yeah, Kieran Hines. Yep.
Wait, the first one or the second one?
Kieran Hines.
Snyder Cut or the...
Yes, he was both.
Okay, all right. Idris Elba.
Okay.
Johnny Whitworth. And Nicolas Cage.
Wow, what the hell garbage did you watch?
What about Ghost Rider? Wait for it.
Spirit of Vengeance.
We have recently spoken of the first Ghost Rider that I did watch. We did the rest of the show. Evelyn, very into it. Very, very into that idea.
Yeah, really.
Which I don't know how she... I think the only way she knows Ghost Rider is...
from PBS. And then she thought it was... And then she realized it was Ghost Rider, not Ghost Writer.
She's like, the Roman Polanski film? I'm like, no, the Marvel comic character.
You don't remember Ghost Rider, the TV show on PBS?
Oh boy. No.
It was on
yes,
it was maybe? On it was on either for me, it was on either right before or right after. I think it was on right after Wishbone. I freaking loved Wishbone, man. Do you remember Wishbone?
Two words I've got to Google now. No.
Wishbone he was the dog that told stories.
You're like kid 90-ing me right now. I'm like, "Oh, do I got footage of this somewhere up here?"
He was a dog and I think it was a Jack Russell that told stories. Like he didn't tell stories, but he would like in the I remember in the opening he dressed up like Shakespeare. He's got like the hat on and everything and like the puffy coat and it was wow. Yeah, Wishbone and Ghost Rider were huge for me.
Not ringing a bell at all. Wishbone. I think I might have missed this one.
As I was too old for that show and still watched it with my friends because we were like, "Dude, this is the stuff." It was so good.
Ghost Rider 1989. This is a bad thing to IMDb. There's way too many.
Oh yeah, that show went on forever.
I'm looking at the Judy Landers, Audrey Landers vehicle, Ghost Rider.
It looks
like one of them, they're both in a convertible. One of them is indeed a ghost. Looks like Marilyn Monroe, quite possibly.
Definitely a different show.
Ghost Rider, Spirit of Vengeance.
Yes. Okay. This
is a movie.
I've only seen it once.
No, watch it again.
I actually almost did turn on the first one, and then I was like, well, I'd have to watch both of them. Be careful.
So the first one, I'm not going to relitigate, but I liked even more this recent time, and it was never something that I watched regularly or thought was good the first time I watched it. And this is, I think, want to say pre-film school. So, you know, if I didn't think it was good pre-film school, what hope is there? But Ghost Rider 2, I remember very much also not liking when it came out. In fact, I might have seen them pretty close together. I don't think I watched them in the theater. So, but it was at that time where, oh my gosh, a Ghost Rider movie? Like,
yeah.
This is impossible. A second one with Nicolas Cage? I don't know why I have so many notes on this as is, and I certainly don't need to spend that much time on it, but it's my finale, so here goes.
Who's the bad guy in that movie?
It is Kieran Hines. That's part of the issue
right,
with this thing.
Right, but who is it? But I mean, who is he playing? Is he Nightmare?
So that's the issue. I know that Peter Fonda was Mephistopheles, technically, yeah, even though you just say the devil, right?
Quote unquote, he was Mephisto.
Yes. The Kieran Hines character is Rourke, is all it says in IMDb. But they give you the idea that not only is he the devil, but that he's the one that initially signed the contract with Johnny Blaze. So I think this movie was, let's say, rewritten at some point.
No.
Many times, possibly. In fact, what did I owe it? Yes. So Peter Fonda was apparently offered to come back and did say publicly he was interested in it until he read 5 pages of the script and flat out refused, I guess, is how that went. Which I don't know how. Again, I do think the first one's better than the second one, but I don't know that it's necessarily you read the whole script and you agree to do it still. I feel like that would have been an issue of, you know, where Peter Fonda saw what we saw in that Peter Fonda as the devil. That sounds pretty good.
Oh,
yeah,
I see.
Let's make that happen.
He was. So Rourke was just another. He was Mephisto. He was just in a different.
So, yeah. But they try to like retcon it to where he was the one from the first one. Is it? I like Kieran Hines a lot. Peter Fonda as the devil, he is not. You know, like, unfortunately. Who is?
Peter Fonda, he is not.
I'm sure there are many instances where Peter Fonda would not have done as good a job in the role that Kieran Hines would have done. Russian bad guy, for example.
All I'm seeing right now is that Christopher Lambert was in the movie and he should have just played the part.
Christopher Lambert, you're right. Number one, I didn't mention that in the cast list because I'm an idiot. But also, he's in it for such a short time and yet still underwent 3 months of sword training, which he's a Highlander. Why did he need to do that?
Well, you got to re-up,
I guess. And also very much shaved his head for the role. He plays a monk. And he plays a monk with a bunch of tattoos on his face. And apparently the process of getting all the tattoos on his head, like his entire body, I guess, is tattooed. But, you know, the stuff that showed. Apparently that role or process was so arduous that he opted to not take it off at the end of the day and just went back to his hotel room wearing the stuff and wherever else he went for the rest, I guess.
Smart.
Which just speaks to Chris Lambert as one of the best that just for this tiny role doesn't care. He's like, he always seems to do the most best awesome job.
Well, yeah, and that speaks to, I this is so dumb, but there was an article about Mortal Kombat recently where it came out that he was cast for Raiden. They didn't have enough money to bring him to Thailand, even though they really wanted to have him in Thailand so that it would look better. And he just said, I'll just come.
Yeah.
And he just paid for his own way, paid for his hotel. He was like hanging out. He paid for parties for people. Like, what the hell, man?
Serious. Yeah. They're like, sorry, Chris, we can't afford you. And he's like,
I can afford
I'll take care of it.
He's like, he said,
everyone can afford
it. He said, I don't think so.
He's a Chris Lambert for the people.
I don't think so.
Anyway, he's great. In this movie that literally as I'm writing, you know what? Anytime Ghost Rider is actually on the screen is kind of massively entertaining. Literally as I'm typing that, there's the bit where he's talking to the kid and the kid's like, because Danny is in this movie who I guess they hint at as... the second Ghost Rider.
Danny Ketch.
Yes, Ketch, that's right. quite the catch. He talks to him and is like, what's it like when you pee? And he's like a flamethrower. And then it cut, like, as stupid as that line is, it cuts to somebody having done the CGI work on Ghost Rider, you know, doing a flamethrower pee. Doesn't end there. Ends with him like turning to camera and going,
I do not remember that.
It's so stupid. And there's a callback to it also. It's so dumb, but it's like, that's so bad it's good. And whenever Ghost Rider is on the screen, it is kind of so massively entertaining for not only that reason, but also it has this complete balls to the wall approach to it. That's, you know, the rock music is going and he's tearing through people left and right while he's smiling. And he's got this weird movement thing too. I don't know who did the mocap on him. Pretty sure it wasn't Nick Cage, but I like the take, actually.
Sure.
It's good to watch. No good, but I was pleased with enjoying something in the film because the rest isn't necessarily very enjoyable. So
fair enough.
This is also the movie I have some bad trivia for, if you'd like it.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Trivia, yeah.
For, surprise, surprise, Ghost Rider, Spirit of Vengeance. At around 51 minutes, one villain is brought back to life and changed so that everything he touches decays, which I guess Blackout, I think, is the name of the actual character, but...
Well, Blackheart was in the first movie, but...
Yeah, no, I'm pretty sure it's Blackout, but he's apparently so different from the comic character that he doesn't deserve the name. Bad trivia, courtesy IMDb. Later, when he is driving the ambulance, everything that he takes out of the lunchbox decays except for the Twinkie. The preservatives used in Twinkies give them such a long shelf life that the joke is that they will literally stay fresh forever, which is why his powers don't work on them.
Oh!
Solid bit from the movie. I like that the trivia has descended into explaining the joke territory.
That's how you know it's good.
That's how you know it's good. Bad trivia. So... I guess I do. I have a couple other. It's directed by the Crank guys, which I don't like the Crank movies. So maybe the best thing Spirit of Vengeance did was break up that directing duo. Apparently they have not worked together again since that movie. So credit where credit is due.
Penance stare.
Also, they make a good point that the skull in this movie, which I think the effects are very good in both Ghost Rider movies somehow.
Okay.
Sure. I like them. A great deal.
I remember that that was the whole thing. They were like, we're spending the entire budget on making his head look good.
They put the money in the right spot. I don't like the choice in the second movie, in Spirit of Vengeance, where the skull is charred. It looks like it has been burning rather than being a clean skull that's on fire.
Yeah, it's stupid. Yeah.
I think that was a bad choice, but other than that, also a bad movie. And that's all I got. If I haven't won by now, then it's not going to happen. So. All
right. Well, I'll go down this list here. You tell me what you want to hear about, and I will give you a brief.
Oh, I get to choose your finale? I get to choose how I lose? Okay. I like it. That's fine.
I'll give you a brief thing. Deadpool 2.
Oh, wait. Which version?
Just the plain.
Okay. Skip. Now, if it's not Once Upon a Time, we can talk about it later. Once Upon a Deadpool.
Sonic the Hedgehog.
I'm going to watch that, so... I'll leave it up to you if you want to have, again, a discussion. We can have a Kid 90 Sonic the Hedgehog double feature discussion.
The one thing I'll say about Sonic the Hedgehog is both James Marsden, who I don't care. I universally like the guy. I fully
think that's his thing, though, right?
I fully attribute it to, like, I liked him always, but I fully attribute it, like, his universal pass to 30 Rock.
Cyclops. Yes, 30 Rock, of course.
I meant Cyclops. The whole nine yards.
Oh, which one?
There's the whole nine yards and then the sequel, the whole 10 yards.
Oh, you're right. That's not the remake one. No. There's what am I thinking about? The longest yard, maybe?
Oh, those are fun, though.
That,
man,
the Burt Reynolds.
The remake of The Longest Yard, not as good, but really fun. And also super, super fun if you're a wrestling fan, because, like, there's a bunch of wrestlers in it.
Okay. Wow. Yeah, I might force you into that. I don't know. What are the rest real quick? Maybe? Let's do it that way.
Well, I know what my finale is going to be, but then we've got Cool World.
Wow, man. You did go on a trip.
And Stargate.
Okay. This is hard. This is harder than I thought it was going to be. I need to show Stargate 2 Evelyn, could also be a...
After having just watched it, that movie holds up so well. Especially because you just went through Next Generation.
We did.
The way this movie feels is like a big budget Next Generation movie. Like that's how it totally feels to me after like just kind of thinking about it for a while. Not in the world, but it feels like a Next Generation style story. You know what I mean? Like,
the two extremes, it's a Star Trek, not a Star Wars.
100%. And the costuming in that movie is out of this world good. Like it's outrageously great. And also real weird seeing Jimon Hanzu as like a baby. He's so young in this movie. Like
he's an actual Digimon.
And he's a Digimon. It's weird to see him without a little gray fuzz on his face. Like he's got he's just clean shaven and Digimon.
Yeah, I will watch that very soon.
Definitely. And one of the things that you've got to appreciate when you watch that movie is notice how many practical effects they went with. In like there is plenty of CG in there, but when you watch the way that they mix the CG with the practical stuff, like it's a for the time, man, it's a terrific work. Fantastic.
Okay, so I'm looking at a Stargate Kid 90 Sonic triple feature.
It's gonna be your nightmare
conversation.
Cool World is a because I really briefly want to mention they did an episode of How Did This Get Made on this movie, and I was listening to it, and I actually saw the movie in the theater, and I've seen it a number of times. Beth had never even heard of this movie. And
really,
she was listening to this and she kept saying, "What are they talking about?" And I finally showed her the trailer for it. And I was like, "Yeah, it's got Gabriel Byrne and Kim Basinger and all this, but that's not really, and Brad Pitt, but that's not actually the interesting part. The best part of this movie is that it's the animation in it is second to none." And of course, because it's like Ralph Bakshi, basically, right? So, Ralph Bakshi's animation is some of the best animation that ever existed in film. And the way this movie engages his style of animation along with a number of other flavors throughout the movie and blends them seamlessly into this world, along with the fact that one of my favorite bits is that when Gabriel Byrne is pulled into Cool World and Brad Pitt to a degree, a number of the scenes they used cardboard cutouts they made cartoon looking cardboard cutouts of the background of cars of stuff. So he has something to walk around, and it's totally but there's something about it that works so well for me. It's a terrible movie. It's a guy like the movie barely makes sense in terms of why anything is happening, but boy, is it pretty to look at, and the animation for it is, again, just second to none. Totally worth the time.
So Bakshi directed it too.
Yeah.
Other animation credits of his that you might.
Wizards. Wizards is love that movie. The Lord of the Rings. Fritz the Cat.
Okay, yeah. I did not need to bring up the IMDb. Halloween 3, Season of the Witch. Cannonball Run 2.
That's right. The Cannonballer.
Bakshi. Okay.
Yeah, Ralph Bakshi, though, man. Wizards, out of all of his straight-up animated movies, lots of people love Lord of the Rings, but Wizards is... I cannot recommend it enough. It is a terrific movie.
Wizards now on the list always. That's why these shows are hard. I end up with a larger list than before.
My finale will end with the Oscar nominated and very likely to win an Oscar.
Well, this is not Ghost Rider Spirit of Vengeance.
Directed by Chloe Zhao, starring Francis, just give me the Oscar now, McDormand, David Strathairn. Nomadland.
Jason Statham. Oh, nice.
Yeah. Jason Statham and David Strathern are very similar people.
I want to show up for one of their movies interchangeably. Hey, it's a Jason Statham movie. We get there. Oh, it's...
I want to see David Strathern in any of the roles Statham played in Guy Ritchie movies or in Crank. Honestly, you don't think Crank is good now, but you'll love it with David Strathern.
I would. I would like that version much more.
So Nomadland.
I'm sorry, Nomadland.
Nomadland was a movie that I didn't have any familiarity with. I didn't see any trailers for it. I didn't know anything about it until basically Oscar buzz kind of hit. And I saw, oh, it's directed by Chloe Zhao, why do I know that name? So I had to look up her name. She is going to be directing the Eternals movie.
Right.
So we're one of those directors. We've got art house stuff here. Okay, I'm into that. And then,
have you heard the buzz on that thing so far?
The Eternals? No.
It sounds amazing until you consider everything about it, and it's complete bait. But, you know, it would be nice. It's that movie has been viewed internally at Marvel, and that they are, quote, amazed at what they have. Like blown away at what they have. Could totally be possible. But holds very little weight with me, that actual story.
In terms of the Eternals and who they are and their direct relation to the previous phases, yeah, there's a lot that could go on here. So here's a fun fact. The Eternals have a direct connection to Thanos. As in, Thanos was created by the Eternals. So that's the whole thing.
Okay.
But then this movie having Frances McDormand and David Strathern, and I was like, okay, you can't go wrong with these actors. The movie revolves around Frances McDormand's character. Her name is Fern. She lives in a van. She's got a van that she's built out, not in a van down by the river. I
didn't say it. I wasn't going to say it. I was tight-lipped.
I could see the Farley face. You had a Farley face going on.
The Farley comes out. When the Farley comes out, you can't.
It's.
I shouldn't have fought it.
You're Farley. Farley, 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 Farley. Hello. I don't remember what else he says, but he does say Farley a whole bunch in Three Amigos. In Three Amigos. So she basically suffers like the loss of like everything, like her family, everything during a recession, the recent recessions. So the movie takes place in like 2012 or something. And it's based on a book that was based on some real people. And there are a number of other actors in this movie are not professional actors. They're van dwellers. They're people that live that life. And the movie is very much a slice of life of this character, Fern, not even figuring out. She's happy as a clam doing her. She works for Amazon at the picker factory. When she moves away from that area, she goes and works somewhere else for a little while. She kind of does odd jobs to make enough money to keep her van going and to just live. And you get a little insight into when a number of these nomads essentially get together and they spend time together. They bring out all the stuff they have and they trade with each other and all that. And she meets David Strathern, who kind of shows a little interest in her, but not like overly while there's kind of a love story, it's not overwrought. It's not the, like, we could both be nomads together. It's not that at all. It's very
much... The movie isn't a love story, you would say?
No, not at all. No, it's definitely her life. And watching this movie, just like watching Three Billboards, like you watch this and you go, yeah, I mean, Frances McDormand she's a freaking American treasure. You know, she's a national treasure. That woman is an amazing actor and she does a great job with this movie. The story is it's a powerful story because it very much trades in a form of reality that is looked down upon because it's part of the unknown. It's how can anybody want to not live in a comfortable home with all these things and to themselves and so many of these people choose to live this way. They may have been forced that way at one point, but she specifically goes out of her way to note throughout the movie that that she built this van. Like she took the van and she added the toilet to it and the bed and the pullout storage and all this stuff where she has stuff. She did that because this is where
is a toilet in the van.
Oh yeah. Just like this is van dwelling, man. People have toilets in their vans.
Where does it go? There's a hole in the bottom?
No. So there's a gas tank when you have gas, you know?
Oh gosh.
No, it,
you're right. This should win the Academy Award.
But it's you know, it's like everything else. There's a place for the waste to go. And yeah, I mean, she only does it. She puts the car on auto drive and then she goes and does her business hauling down the highway. It's fine.
Well, now I'm interested.
Yeah, no, you should be.
Okay.
It's a terrific movie, man. It's a best picture, best actor, all that stuff. She's her best actress. I will be surprised if this movie is not loved heavily through the Oscars, but yeah, I mean, this is a terrific movie, giving some really interesting backstory and shedding some light on a real demographic of people.
So many questions, none of them appropriate.
Okay.
Is there anything you can say about the story, about what makes that good without spoiling it? I don't think we need to spoil it necessarily.
You're getting, so you're getting, again, it's a slice of life. So it's
okay.
It's kind of hard to break that out without kind of spoiling it, but it's not really like, it's less about spoiling and less about like there. It's less about having a spoiler for the movie and more about the experience of kind of engaging with the character and trying to put aside your own biases and your own, well, nobody would ever do this, when this is literally something people are doing. They do it now. They have forever. Like, this is not new. And most people are going to have some kind of a bias there about, I would never do that, or I could never see myself doing that, or how could anybody do that? And this kind of addresses all of that.
Okay. All right, cool. I'm curious now, and I don't think you can answer this either, but about the pacing, because of the type of movie.
Oh, it's great.
To be.
It moves along really well, and it does so in a smart way where you, because it's that, like, I know I've said this 50 times now, but because of the slice of life aspect to it, the editing works along with that. So you kind of get some serious, you get some good beats with her life and what she's doing here and why she's here and what she's doing here. And she moved here now. And that for like, it's like an hour and 45 minutes, I think. It moved. I admit, I wanted to watch this movie, but when we turned it on, I was super like not in the frame of mind of, I want to watch a serious movie. It drew me in and I didn't realize how quickly it had gone by.
Okay, cool. Well, you've definitely won this week. You brought in the Oscar cannon and fired it right at my face.
Hey, what if I do this though? Okay. What if we say this week is a wash and next week we bring in an Oscar cannon and fire it at each other's faces.
Hey, sounds like a plan. Are you speaking of Minari?
I certainly am. Let's go ahead and give Minari a watch this week, everybody, on the book club for movies.
Or next week, you know, Monday morning.
Monday
morning. Oh, actually, I guess that we record Monday morning, but the podcast doesn't come out until midweek-ish. So, you know, yeah, you could watch it. Minari is the one we're doing next time, everybody. So come back for Minari and email us at bookclub4movies.com. You can talk to us about anything we've talked about this week, last week, or any other week. And Facebook or Twitter, where again, we live in part. Until then, we love and appreciate you because you're cool and good looking, and hope to be at your house soon.
I see you! Goodbye!